Welcome back to Chinese 270, China in the West. So where had we left off last week? We had just started to accompany Marco Polo on his journey to China. And I had left you with a bunch of questions, right? And here are two. Where were the Polos headed? What did people call the land to the Far East where silk was said to originate? And why is the answer to this question so relevant to our class, China and the West? But let's recap Marco Polo's journey, right? We said he set out in Venice. He probably first traveled by boat to Antioch. This will sound familiar to BART writers, right? You all know that. And then through what we call now the Middle East, Persia, Afghanistan, into the Yuan domain, the Yuan Empire. And as we will see today, right, we then accompanied him on his travels south to Quanzhou. And also, just to recap, right, we had discussed these different terms for China, and we had wondered what we should actually call this entity where he went to, whether we should call it China under the Yuan, or the Yuan as a Chinese dynasty, or a Mongolian dynasty, or should we refer to it as Cathay? We had discussed that Cathay was really a term used to describe the northern tribes that had eventually conquered China. And then we learned the term Mangi or Manzi, right? That was really a derogatory term for the people of the southern Song, but that, especially in European usages, really just became an alternative term for China because Marco Polo had introduced it to the West. Oh, and then just as a reminder, here was that assignment. I really wanted you to carefully look at that passage from Beijing to Quanzhou and look what Marco Polo thought was noteworthy, and of course to what degree his account allows us to speculate about the real situation in China at the time and how it compared to Europe. And then I had suggested in the forum descriptions, right, that you could focus maybe on infrastructure, roads, schools, fire brigades, public buildings, commerce, business, trade, guilds. Why is this place so wealthy? How do people live on a daily basis? What do they eat, wear, own? How is the empire governed? How is the city organized? What do people do in their leisure time? What do people believe in? And of course, here is a map of that trajectory, right? He's setting out in Beijing, Dadu, right? And then he's following the Grand Canal. I'll talk more about that later. Eventually to Suzhou, Hangzhou, and then all the way to Quanzhou. And of course, I wanted you to also bear a few other questions in mind, right? And that was, what was the effect of Marco Polo's account on readers in Europe? What effect did it have on the emergence of the idea of China? How did they, that is, people back in Europe, his readers, imagine China to look? What effect has his account on Sino-Western relations? And this question of how did they imagine China to look, this is an interesting one, because a lot of, the books of Marco Polo's travels, the Book of the Marvels of the World, was later illustrated. The first manuscript that he left us with, or of course didn't have any images. Images were later added, and of course it was added by people who themselves had never been to China, who would base their illustrations on Marco Polo's accounts. So here we have an interesting account, right? Taking farewell from Kublai Khan, Marco Polo leaving. So Marco Polo, right, he probably leaves what we would imagine an Italian of the 13th century to look, but is this how we would imagine Kublai Khan to have looked? And why did he look this way? These are, of course, all really interesting questions. Maybe we can discuss them in more detail in our discussion session. But let's look at the text a little closer, and I want to share with you some of the passages that I think are really interesting. I highlighted them here in yellow. The people thrive on trade and industry, right? There is so much emphasis on this bustling economy. They are idolaters. What does that mean? It comes up again and again, right? So Marco Polo obviously notices that they are clearly not Christians, right? That they pray to idols, and they use paper money of the great Khan, their lord, right? And I said he repeats this. Why does he repeat this so often? You know, is he so impressed by this? Is he so shocked by this? it's interesting, right? This idea about, you talk so much about religion. Here's another thing practiced in Cathay that you should know about. Among the idolaters, there are 84 idols, each with its own name. The idolaters say that the Supreme God has given each idol a requisite power. So if you've been to China or East Asia, or you've been maybe even to a temple, a Buddhist temple elsewhere, right? You've probably seen that a lot of East Asian folk religion, Buddhist or Taoist, and sometimes, of course, they are merged, right? They pray to a lot of different deities, right? And that, of course, is a major difference to monotheistic religions like Christianity. He keeps mentioning paper money, right? That, to him, must have been just amazing. We know that, really, the Yuan were the first to implement widespread use of paper money. And here you have a stone plate that would have been used to print them. And here on the right, you have a bill. So let's see what else he describes. Oh, here he talks about what the girls wear. They wear pretty bonnets designed to prevent them from looking up, so that they always walk with their eyes cast down on the ground in front of their feet, always tread with such dainty steps that they never put one foot in front of the other by more than a finger's length. The Tartars do not trouble themselves with such niceties, for their daughters as well as their wives go riding with them. And this is a really interesting observation. I wonder if you can figure out what he is talking about. Yeah, he's really talking about this practice of foot binding. Now, foot binding developed in the 10th century and became popular during the Song Dynasty, which time only a very small part of the upper classes would have followed that custom, right? Because it essentially meant that women bound their feet and they could barely walk, and they would be largely confined to the house. You know, they wouldn't be able to work the field. So if you were a farmer, you wouldn't be able to do that to start with. So essentially, to have women bind their feet was also a status symbol. It was a symbol of wealth, essentially. Now, only during the Ming Dynasty, much later, and especially during the Qing, did it become common among elite women. So during Marco Polo's times, it wasn't yet very widespread. But some people, especially in the southern parts, would have done it, and you would have observed it. The Mongols themselves did not do it. And here you have another image, right, of Kublai Khan's Dadu or Beijing. And again, does this look like a city that we would imagine, you know, Beijing to have looked in the 13th century? And if not, what does it look like? And why? All right, let's look at the text again. At the end of the three-day journey, he reaches the noble city of Xinzhou Mato, which is extremely large and wealthy and a thriving center of trade and crafts. I can further tell you that they have a river from which they derive great profit, and I will tell you how. The fact is that the major river flows from the south as far as the city of Xinzhou Mato, whose townspeople have made two rivers out of this one big one, for they have channeled half of it to the east and the other half to the west, so that the one leads to Manzi, right, the southern part of the empire, and the other through Cathay, the northern part. And believe me when I say that this city possesses such extensive shipping, that is, such a huge number of vessels, that no one would credit it without seeing it. Yet you should not suppose that they are large ships. Rather, they are just the type suited to navigate a large river. Moreover, I assure you that the volume of merchandise shifted to Manzi and across Cathay on board these boats is quite astonishing. Not only that, but when they come back, they are laden with return cargoes. So all in all, it is a marvelous thing to see the goods that are shipped up and down this river. So what is he talking about here? He's talking about Xinzhou Mato, today's Jining in Shandong province. And that was the site that controlled the flow of the waters of the Grand Canal, which was an amazing canal that connected the north with the south, that had been the construction of which had been started back in the 6th century, really meant to facilitate the transportation of grain from the rich, fertile lands of the south to the north, and just trade in general. And it was under the Yuan that the canal that had fallen into disrepair was revitalized. And here you have an image, I'm not quite sure from when that is, but it sort of gives you an idea of that scene. And of course, he talks about those river boats, not ocean-going vessels, but the ship river boats that would have been hauled along the canal. And I have a map here of the canal, right? So you see here Dadu, Beijing in the north, and then Hangzhou here in the south, and Jining Xinzhou is right there, right? And what he calls a river really is part of that canal. So rivers, of course, were used, but large sections, of course, of the canal were actually also dug, so they were real canals. And if we want to put that into perspective, right, once more, here's that map with Beijing, Dadu here, and then Hangzhou, and then right here's Xinzhou, Jining. So we'll follow him down, and here you have a map of today's China, if you want to compare that. And he talks about those wares, right? Those riches that are traded along the river. What are some of the things that would have been traded, right? Maybe porcelain, chalcedon of the Song Dynasty, this beautiful whitish porcelain with a light blue hue to it. By the way, this is a good moment for me to remind you that if you've never been to the San Francisco Asian Art Museum, you should all go. That's an extra assignment from this class, and have a look at the beautiful Chinese porcelain there. And then he eventually heads for another city called Xinzai, and he spends a lot of time talking about Xinzai. Now, Xinzai is today's Hangzhou, which throughout history always has been praised as one of the most marvelous and richest and beautiful cities in China. So this is what he has to say about Hangzhou or Xinzai. And since we have now arrived in Xinzai, we will describe it to you in its full splendor. It is well worth recording because it is, without doubt, the finest and noblest city in the world. Page 196, if you want to follow along in the PDF. Xinzai is about 100 miles in circumference because its streets and canals are very big and wide. There are squares where they hold markets, which, on account of the vast crowds that gather in them, are necessarily very large and spacious. The city is situated in such a way that one side is a crystal clear fresh water lake, while on the other is a huge river that flows into every part of the city along numerous canals, both large and small, carrying away all its waste before flowing into the lake and onwards towards the ocean. Very interesting. He's even commenting on the sewage system in the city. There are said to be 12,000 bridges, mostly built of stone, though some are made of wood. There are 1,600,000 houses, many of which are palatial mansions. You may also take my word for it that all the streets of the city are paved with stone and brick. So too are all the roads and causeways of the entire province of Mansi, so that you can ride or walk across any part of it without getting your feet dirty. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing, the amount of detail he gives us? And again, I think it's so interesting to just ask yourself, why is he telling us this, right? Can we maybe conclude that in Europe, in Venice, at the same time, you could not walk across the street without getting your feet dirty? You did not have hygiene and a sewage system? Just throwing that out there. But he has more to say about the city, right? He talks about, again, commerce, right? Large stone warehouses where all the merchants who come from India and elsewhere store their goods and merchandise in order to be conveniently close to these squares. Three times a week, a market is held in each of these squares, attracting crowds of 40,000 to 50,000 people who bring everything. It could be designed in a way of food, but produce is always in plentiful supply, whether it be game, roebuck, red deer, fallow deer, hares, rabbits, birds such as partridges, pheasants, francolins, quails, chickens, capons, and untold quantities of ducks and geese, which they rear in such numbers on the lake that a brace of geese and two brace of ducks can be had for one Venetian silver groat. I think he's probably telling us that it's dead cheap compared to Venetian prices. And then he says other streets house all the doctors and astrologers who also teach reading and writing. And countless other professions have their own quarters around these squares. Whenever anyone plans to travel abroad, he consults an astrologer and tells him his horoscope. Okay, but I'll leave it at that for now, and I will see you shortly for our second course lecture.